When was the last time you saw a company stock jump by 15% because they decided to sell off 2/3 of their business? Well, that's exactly what happened to Georg Fischer last week. And here's the crazy part. While in 2015, General Electric couldn't wait to get rid of its water division, in 2024, Georg Fischer is getting rid of everything but its water division. So what changed? Many of my 250 podcast guests have been repeating to me that we are at an inflection point. Well, if anyone had a doubt, it's happening right in front of our eyes. But what drove this complete reversal in how companies view their water divisions? What makes water technology so much more valuable today than a decade ago? Are we seeing the birth of a new generation of water giants, and will this trend counterintuitively accelerate industry consolidation?
I also have lots of questions.
Let's review. Let's start with the facts. Last week, Georg Fischer, or GF, to stick with the pillows in my background, because yes, full disclosure, when I'm not too witty on YouTube, GF is my employer. So GF announced the sell-off of its machining solutions division for 630 to 650 million Swiss francs. They also announced they were strategically evaluating the casting solutions division with similar sell-off intentions. As a result, the company that had concluded its biggest M&A move ever with the acquisition of Uponor last year instantly became a water and flow pure player, which is quite a dramatic shift from being an industrial conglomerate. But talking of industrial conglomerates, here's, I believe, an interesting comparison across time. People often confuse GF with GE, one letter apart in the alphabet, understandable. Well, back in 2017, GE was proactively reworking its portfolio by, and I quote, focusing on core industrial businesses and divesting slower growth, low tech and non-industrial practices. And what did they sell off in that process? Exactly, GE Water, which they sold to Suez to create Suez WTS, nowadays Veolia WTS, and you'll see that this will come back later. So, roughly a decade ago, when an industrial conglomerate wanted to strategically run a divestment, it divested its water arm. I mean, that's true for GE, it has been true in turn for Siemens, and even Veolia, if we go back to the roots of the Vivendi story. Meanwhile, water assets were used somewhat like hot potatoes. I've already covered it in great depth, so go watch my Xylem Evoqua merger story after this one if you want to know more. But what would become Evoqua has been treated like that said hot potato, changing hands from Veolia to Siemens to AEA investors with decreased valuation at each step, while that same Evoqua is now worth more than $7 billion as part of Xylem, which shows just how much valuations in water technology have evolved. So what has changed within that decade? What is actually happening in the water technology market today?
You ask good questions.
You make me blush.
Well, numbers and market studies are worth what they are, so take it with a pinch of salt. What's interesting here is not the actual big number with all its zeros, but the trend. So, according to Global Water Intelligence and XPV's analysis they published last year, supported by a wonderful, clever, and sexy webinar host,
stop lying, Riley, and stop wasting our time!
Water solution and technology companies will see their total value increase from $290 billion to $1.4 trillion between 2024 and 2034. That's a 4.8-fold increase. But what may be even more telling is how the capital employed in water security-related assets will evolve. We're talking of a jump from $3.8 trillion to $12.6 trillion over that decade. That's not valuation, that is actual capital deployed, which reflects in water companies' top line. Indeed, look at GF. In 2023, their water division generated 286 million Swiss francs in operating profit, while their two other arms only delivered 64 and 60 million respectively. So water wasn't just their biggest business, it was nearly twice as profitable as their other two divisions combined. Let me put that in simpler terms. 10 years ago, you sold off your water division because it was the less profitable part of your operations. Today, you sell everything else because it is the most profitable part of those same operations. I know it is a shortcut, but it's kinda right still. But wait, I gave you the GF example and now I'm implying there's a trend. One event is not a trend, right? You're right, it's not. That's why there's more than one event. In May 2024, DuPont announced they're splitting into three independent companies.
Every magic trick consists of three parts, or acts.
to create what they call a comprehensive water solutions provider with leading filtration technologies. We're not talking about a small division here. DuPont Water Solutions alone generates $1.5 billion in revenue with a remarkable 24% operating margin. 24%, that's sizable and we'll come back to it, but it might not be the full picture still. Christopher Gasson looked at it for GWI and I believe he captures it pretty right. It's a beautiful business from a private equity point of view because so much of its revenue from membrane and ion exchange resin sales is repeat business. In other words, it's not just about selling technology, it's about creating long-term, stable cash flows. Wouldn't you love that as an investor?
Oh, I like money.
Okay, so GF, DuPont, who else? Well, Danaher had already picked up on this trend. In September 2023, they completed the spin-off of Veralto, which includes their water analysis and treatment businesses. What's funny with that one is the market's reaction. I mean, for GF, it was telling. You sell an arm, you insta-win 15%, speaks for itself, right? For DuPont, the market reacted positively, but not as spectacularly. And they split in three, so telling who gets credit for what is harder. But for Danaher, well, the share price actually went down. Wouldn't it contradict all I'm saying so far? No, Danaher is the non-water arm. Now, the water arm is Veralto, so that shows that investors valued the water-related Veralto assets even more than the remaining Danaher portfolio. So here we have three real-life examples of what I'm saying. Split off or refocus on your water arm and boom, profit.
Oh, why did we choose a shortcut?
Because I'm lazy? But what if more companies applied that tactic? I mean, if water tech is the place to be for investors, then you should want to dress as a water technology company, right? Well, Christopher Gasson actually did that exercise for GWI recently. I put the link in the comments. By the way, I'm not endorsed by GWI by any stretch of the imagination, but my friend Bjorn is. So if you want to get access to their content, use the code BJORN10 and you'll get 10% off and he might owe me a beer. Well, back to Christopher's article. He started from this simple question. Veolia has roughly 45 billion euros of yearly revenues against $7.4 billion for Xylem. Yet, the company's valuation is about 21 billion euros against $30 billion for Xylem. So Veolia has over 6 times the revenue of Xylem, yet its market capitalization is 1/3 lower. How can it be? Well, here comes the trend we're discussing since the beginning of this video. Xylem is a water tech pure player, while Veolia has about 60% of its business, give or take, in waste management, and only 40% in water endeavors, of which, again, about 1/4 are in water tech. So if the world was a monopoly game, you could envision to split Veolia in three, or at least spin out its water tech arm, which, if we apply the Xylem multiples to it, would result in a $20 billion valuation for that alone. As Christopher puts it, something extraordinary is happening in the industrial water sector and the public markets haven't fully cottoned onto it yet. Now, that analysis itself has one more level of irony in it, because Veolia's water tech arm is not only but widely about Veolia WTS. Veolia WTS is what's born from the acquisition of Suez WTS. And Suez WTS is... Kudos to you in the back, you followed through the maze. Yes, Suez WTS is the former GE Water. So that's the irony. A decade ago, an industrial conglomerate spun out its water arm as it was, let me quote again, slower growth, low tech, and today, an activist investor may well battle to get that same water arm spun out again from a different conglomerate because it's too high growth and too attractive to be trapped in that larger body.
Oh, the irony.
So, water tech pure plays are really, really trendy right now, which begs the question, why? Evolution, I guess, or said differently?
I'm simply saying that life finds a way.
Or maybe more seriously, the forces driving this strategic repositioning reveal a profound shift in the importance of water technology. Simply put, there are three main growth drivers that are reshaping the water tech landscape. First, there's water quality. Meeting the next generation of regulations will require tripling current investment rates. Then there's infrastructure renewal. Just maintaining current service levels demands doubling investment. And finally, water scarcity. Addressing this, we'll need a 5-fold increase in spending on desalination, reuse, and efficiency technologies. These drivers help explain the broader market dynamics, and this graph helps to grasp it. The global water-related economy represents $86 trillion in water-dependent activities, or, with slight changes from one source to another, 60 to 80% of the world's GDP. Within that, there's a $19.3 trillion water handling economy where water is a major process input. But the real transformation is happening in the $1.9 trillion water management market. That's where companies like GF, DuPont, Veralto, or Veolia are refocusing themselves. Why?
I like money.
Exactly, that's where the highest margins are. When DuPont announced their three-way split, they specifically highlighted their water solutions segment's 24% operating EBITDA margin. Veralto also hovers around 24%, Xylem around 20%, and GF around 16%. So that's the shift. A decade ago, water technology was seen as a capital-intensive, low-margin business, whereas today, it's still capital-intensive, but it's also high-margin and high-growth. And as I told you at the beginning, the total value of water technology companies is projected to increase from $290 billion to $1.4 trillion between 2024 and 2034, which is the kind of increase that's attracting the attention of investors who were previously looking at water as too niche and too complex. It's no coincidence that players like Gradient, Nyhus, or H2 Innovation are now backed by private equity players. In their industrial water market targets, they're not competing on price, they're selling efficiency, reliability, and compliance, and in turn, their rapid growth demonstrates how the market has shifted from seeing water technology as a cost center to viewing it as a strategic asset. But there's one more dimension to this shift, and it brings us back to Georg Fischer's move. GF's strategic evaluation concluded that focusing entirely on water and flow solutions was the best way forward, widely for the reasons I already mentioned, but not only. Indeed, their acquisition of Uponor for 2.1 billion Swiss francs at the end of 2023 shows they're not just divesting, they're reshaping themselves into a water powerhouse. And it's not over. When I discussed that with Mats Jorgensen, GF CFO, he told me the following.
We needed to basically have a strengthening of our balance sheet, which we could either decide to do over a decade, 10 years, or we could do it really quick. So that was the trigger. We wanted to focus our cash flow so that we can actually quickly implement our growth ambition.
So in my words, selling everything that's not water to focus on that said water is also a shortcut to rebuilding a stock of dry powder to be used proactively on the market to shop around and consolidate.
What we would ideally do is actually to do a series of, let's say, mid-sized acquisitions. So about ideally 75 to 125 million would be really sort of a sweet spot of stuff you can really quickly buy, quickly finance, quickly integrate.
And consolidation is something that can happen at all levels. I've talked repeatedly of DuPont Water Solutions throughout this video, but to be very honest, I'd be very surprised if that company stands alone for long. Xylem doesn't have membranes in its otherwise pretty exhaustive portfolio, so they may want to bolt on DuPont's impressive RO technologies. Would they have the cash for that so quickly after the Evoqua merger is a different question. But if Xylem can't or doesn't want to do it, I could also think of Pentair as an acquirer, which would be close to a GF Uponor type of deal given the proximity between their portfolios. Or the answer might be in the list of companies we covered today, with Veralto taking over a company that closely resembles its financial profile.
But it's all just speculation at the moment, isn't it?
One thing's for sure, it's not the end of the spectacular move season, so if you don't want to miss out on those and the associated commentary or analysis, make sure to subscribe, and I'll see you next time.